What's up, guys? This is Elliot the iPad Pro, and in this tutorial, I'm going to teach you the basics of Python. So if you go to YouTube and type Python tutorial, you'll see that there's already a ton of really great videos. I actually learned Python from watching YouTube. So you might be wondering, why another Python video? Well, if you go through these videos, you'll see that they're really great at covering the nitty-gritty details of Python. They cover the grammar and syntax of the Python language. But when I think about it, that's not really how I learned how to program. I learned how to program by testing things out and by trying other people's examples. I believe that learning to program should be like learning any other language. You don't learn English by just reading a book on grammar and syntax. Instead, what you do is you find a simple book and you try to read the entire thing. Then you try to write your own simple sentences. So I'm going to show you how to program the same way. I'm going to show you simple examples of what you can do with Python. And this is not meant to replace the other Python videos. I'm going to use the other videos to give you a better understanding of how to program. For instance, if you don't know what a verb is in programming, I'll refer you to another video that explains what a verb is. At the end of this video, I'll tell you how I learned Python, what my favorite videos are, and what websites I go to. Alright, so now let's jump into programming. Now, if you watched the previous video about installing Python, which will be right up there, you'll remember that we created a file called My First Python. So if you just start creating files all over the place, then your Jupyter website is going to get really messy. So let's organize this by putting our file inside of a folder. We'll put this file in a public folder because later you might want to share what you created with other people. To do this, first go into the public folder, then go to New, and create a new folder. Then we have to name the new folder that we created. I'll name it My First Python, but instead of using spaces, I'll use underscores. So My underscore First underscore Python. Then click Rename. Now we'll go to the main folder where the My First Python file is. Then we'll move this Python file into the My First Python folder. If you see that the little file picture is green, that means that that file is still running Python and you have to shut down the file. You can do this by selecting that file and then clicking Shutdown. Once the file is shut down, you can move the file. Select the file and then click Move. Then let's move it to public/my_first_python and click Move. The file is now in My First Python. When you click the file, it'll open the file in a new tab and then it'll start running Python. You'll know that your file is ready to go when this little circle in the right hand corner goes from gray to white. Sometimes this can actually take a while. A way to avoid that is by clicking the lightning bolt icon before you shut down the file. So I know you probably want to really start typing code, but before we do, we should talk a little bit about how a programming language works. Every programming language I've ever seen has three basic jobs, and it's kind of amazing to think that with just these three things, you can do anything you imagine on a computer. First, a programming language gives you a way to make data. Now, data doesn't just mean ones and zeros. It can be anything. It can be a number. It can be a sentence. It can be a song or a video. And once you have that data inside your program, the programming language does another really important thing, and that is it allows you to use tools to manipulate that data. For instance, removing the last word of a sentence changes that sentence, or making a video black and white changes that video. Finally, programming gives you a way to download toolboxes that other people created. And this is really what makes programming so special. Instead of having to build a really hard program from scratch, you can use the tools in other people's toolboxes to create the program that you want. So when you program, you build your program using the tools from other people's programs. And what makes this so beautiful is that if you make your program public, then other people can start to use bits and pieces of your program to build their program. When you program, you're part of a larger community that's working together to build the future. All right, now it's time to start programming. So the first thing to do is to learn how to make data. In our previous program, you already saw that we created data like 2 plus 2 and the word hello. Now we're going to learn how to save that data and then how to use tools to change the data. First, let's run the line of code that makes Jupyter work on an iPad. You can do this by clicking the play button next to the cell or by pressing Shift Enter inside the cell. Now, when you pressed 2 plus 2, it told you that this was 4, but it never saved this anywhere. Now, if you want to save this as the variable x, you can just type x is equal to 2 plus 2. Then, when we run x in a new cell, we see that it is equal to 4. Once data is saved, you can do all sorts of cool stuff with it. For instance, you can do x plus 3, and then it will give you 7, because 4 plus 3 equals 7. Just like how you save numbers, you can also save sentences. So instead of just printing hello world, you can actually save hello world. For instance, let's do y is equal to hello world. Now when we type y, we get hello world. Now we saw what happened when we did x plus 3, but what do you think happens when we do y plus something? Well, let's find out by pressing Shift Enter. Now this might be surprising, but when you do the plus sign between two sentences, you actually get the two sentences combined. You can even save this as a new variable. Now from your math classes, you might be a little confused about how you can have a word plus another word. But let's think about this like a computer scientist. So the words are just data, and the plus symbol is just a tool. And the guy who invented that tool decided that it can be used to combine two words together. You can actually make the plus symbol do whatever you want in Python. Now I could continue typing, but the screen is starting to look a little messy, so let's try to organize this a little. So when the cell is green, if I press space and then shift delete, I go into command mode. This is when the cell is now blue. When I'm in command mode, I can use the minus and plus keys to move in between cells. Then I can use enter to go into edit mode for that cell. I can then go back into command mode by pressing space and shift delete. Now to organize the file, we're going to have to learn how to move around inside a Jupyter IPYNB file. One cool thing you can do is add a cell below where you are by pressing B. You can also add a cell above where you are by pressing A. When you're in command mode, if you press M, you'll turn the cell into a markdown cell. Press enter to go inside the markdown cell. Now a markdown cell is very different than a coding cell. In a markdown cell, you're not writing Python code. Instead, you're writing a description about what your code is doing. For instance, let's describe the code we wrote. This is where we created three variables, colon, x, comma, y, comma, z. Then when we press Shift Enter, we see that we have a description of our code. Now let's create a new cell above our description, and let's turn that into a markdown cell. If you think about it, everything we just did was showing you how to make data. So let's organize all of this into a section and call it how to make data. So let's enter into edit mode, and then press hashtag to create a new section. Now we just type how to make data, and then press shift enter. We now have a cool little arrow. And when we tap the arrow, you can see that we can show and hide the section. You can also show and hide the section by using the bracket keys on your keyboard. Now the next section we're going to cover is how to use tools. So let's go to the bottom of this notebook and create a new section. To do this, we take the very last cell and we turn it into a markdown cell by pressing M. Then we enter into the cell. Then we do hashtag space how to use tools, shift enter. Before we start the tools section, let's make our code look a little prettier. Okay, let's scroll to the top of the screen and close the make data section. When you're in command mode, you can press Control H to hide and show the header. Now that we have everything organized, we have the entire screen of our computer to learn about using tools in Python. So as I said earlier, basically every program just takes data and then manipulates it using tools. So which tools should you learn first? There are so many tools in Python, it's hard to even know where to start. One tool is the plus sign. You saw this when I did 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. You also saw it when I did some words plus some other words. Now, I could show you more of the nitty-gritty tools about how to do math with numbers or how to manipulate sentences, but the tools that I think are the most important are the ones that describe the data, not the ones that change it. I use these tools the most because you have to know what your data is before you're able to change it. I already showed you one of the most important tools, and that's how to print data to the screen. We did this when we typed x, y, z. Now, Jupyter will only print the last line of code that you see. Now, so far, everything we typed has been one line of code. What do you think happens if we type x, new line, y? We should see both x and y on the screen, right? Well, not exactly. All you see is hello world, which is what we saved y as. So what's going on here? Is this a bug? Well, in some sense, kinda yes. Jupyter only will print the last line of code that you type to the screen. Writing code is like writing an English paper. You're gonna have to write multiple lines of code when you're doing it. So how do you print something when you're in the middle of your code? To do this, we use a tool called the print function. Type print parentheses x. Then on a new line, type print parentheses y. Finally, you can type z with no parentheses. We now see everything printed to the screen. Another really important tool is the type function. So we saw that there are numbers in Python, and then there are words or sentences. But what exactly are these things? Well, the type function tells you. So when we type type parentheses 2 in Python, we see int as the output. Well, int stands for integer, and an integer is any number like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. There are other types of numbers called floating numbers, and those are like 1.3, 4.7. Let's see what Python does when we do type for 4.7. We see that it tells us that it's a floating point number. Finally, let's see what happens when we do the type of one of the sentences that we typed earlier. It says str. STR stands for string. In Python, words, sentences, characters, these things are all called strings. So what do you think will happen when we do type parentheses x? Remember that we saved x as equal to 4. When we run it, we get int, and this is because 4 is an integer. Since y is equal to hello world, when we do type of y, we get str, because hello world is a string. Okay, well let's get crazy. Remember the print function earlier? What do you think happens if we do type for print? When we run this, we see that Python tells us that print is one of the primary built-in functions in the Python language. Now you see why type is so useful. It tells you literally what anything is in Python. Now, I really want to show you how to use toolboxes in Python, but before I do that, this notebook looks like it's getting a little messy again. Let's make the how to use tools section a little more organized. To do this, we're going to use subsections. So first, let's create a new cell under how to use tools. When you're in command mode, you can do this by pressing B. We turn the cell into a markdown cell by pressing M. If you want to type Python code, you can turn it back into a code cell by pressing Y. But we want it to be a markdown cell. Then we go into edit mode by pressing Enter. Now type hashtag hashtag to create a subsection. Since the first thing we talked about was printing data to the screen, let's call this print to screen, and then press shift enter. Now the next thing we talked about was how to figure out the type of data in Python. So let's create a new code cell right before we started using the type function. We'll turn this into a markdown cell, and then we'll create a new subsection using two hashtags. We'll call this subsection data types. Finally, let's create one more section in the last cell. So we'll turn this into a markdown cell, and then we'll create a section using a hashtag, and then we'll call this section How to Use Tool Boxes. Now everything is nice and organized. We can see how organized everything is by going into command mode and then pressing shift and left bracket. This will collapse all of the sections. All right, now let's open up the toolboxes section. So I don't really have the time to show you how to use toolboxes in this video, but I'm going to give you a little bit of a teaser so that you're excited about the next video. So first, when you go inside of the code cell, you can download the toolboxes that other people create using the command import. So for instance, there's a toolbox called IPY widgets. You can download this toolbox by running the command import IPY widgets. So the tools inside the IPY widgets toolbox are now downloaded inside your Python program. But how do you use them? Well, to use a toolbox, you type the name of the toolbox, and then you put a period. Then you type the name of the tool you want to use. So for instance, in the IPY widgets toolbox, there's a tool called text. When you type text parentheses, and then you run the command, all of a sudden, you see a text box. You can go inside of this text box and write your own text. In IPY widgets, there's another tool called int slider. And when you type this with the parentheses, you then get a little slider. And when you press the screen, you can change the value of the slider. Next, IPY widgets has another tool called toggle button. When you type this with parentheses, you then get a little button that you can press to turn on and off. So in the next video, I'm going to show you how you can build really cool applications using the IPY widgets toolbox. All right, well that's about all the time that I have for teaching in this tutorial, but I want to tell you about some other great videos that you should check out for learning Python. So if you type Python tutorial into YouTube, you'll see a lot of videos come up from a channel called The New Boston. These videos are done by a guy called Bucky Rogers, and that's actually how I learned Python maybe 5 years ago. A more recent addition to the Python tutorials is Socratica, and her videos are very well done. I am really surprised at the quality of her videos. Another amazing resource is M. Galarnik's Python tutorials. What makes these tutorials so amazing is not only does he have YouTube videos, but he also has fully functioning Python files where you can run Python code. You can check out the tutorials on his GitHub page, and then I also included them in my IO blog, which you can go to by clicking public and then clicking IO blog. Then if you go inside resources, you'll find his tutorials. All right, well, if you guys have questions about my tutorial, definitely write something in the comments. And if you enjoyed the video, please click like and subscribe. This is Elliot the iPad Pro. See you guys next video.